Welcome to lecture number 9. In this lecture, we are going to cover forms in HTML. So related to forms, the topics that we will be covering are form tag in HTML, label, input tag, text inputs, text area, buttons, checkboxes, drop-down boxes, radio buttons, file select, action attribute, and method attribute. Before we get started with forms in HTML, let's first of all know what is a form. As we all have seen in real-world websites, we frequently encounter forms on the websites. So what is the purpose? They are used to collect user input so that the user can interact with the website and enter the data, which can be further submitted to the server for processing. Okay, so let's get started with the first point. That is the first topic. Forms can be created with the help of a form tag. So now we are here, form tag in HTML. The form HTML element represents a document section that contains interactive controls for submitting information. And the form element can be used in this way. So it is a pair tag, and every other form control will be inserted right inside this tag. Now the very first tag that we are going to use inside the form tag is a label. The label HTML element represents a caption for an item in the user interface. Whatever the form controls that we will be using now, every form control will correspond to one label tag. So a label consists of a for attribute. The for attribute is used to specify the type of form element with which a label is bound to. And it can be represented as label and then for equals to for is the attribute, and it is equal to the ID of that specific form element. Next is the input tag. The input HTML element is used to create interactive controls for web-based forms in order to accept the data from the user. Many of our form controls are related to the input tag. So we just change the type of input and it will change its appearance according to that specific type. So let's talk about text input, which is also called as a text box. So the input element of type text creates a basic single line text fields, or you can say text boxes. And they can be represented as input type equals to text. And also, if you want to include the optional attributes, which are the value attribute is a string that contains the current value of the text entered into the text fields. So you may or may not use this value, but if you want some default value, then you can use this value attribute as this. For example, whenever you are loading the web page and you want some default value which is visible inside the text box, then you can use this value attribute equals to some value. And also you can use some other attributes such as ID and name. Normally it is not required, but when we use JavaScript, because in JavaScript we need to perform validations, that time it is mandatory for us to use ID and name. But for a simple HTML form, if we are just practicing how to create a form, the ID and name attribute can be skipped for that specific while. Next is text area. The text area HTML element represents a multi-line plain text editing control useful when you want to allow users to enter a sizable amount of free-form text. For example, a comment on a review or a feedback form. The text areas are somewhat different from the normal text boxes, that is, input type equals to text. It's because it allows the user to adjust the size in real time on the web page, so which is not the thing with the simple text box. And generally, we require text area when we want the user to enter large number of characters, more number of characters. For instance, we can make the user to enter the address of his house. Or let's say you want the comments from the user, you want some kind of feedback from the user. So that time they are very useful. And how to insert a text area? We need to use the text area tag, and these are not associated with the input tag. So you have to use only text area tag. And then we have two attributes called as rows and calls, which help us to adjust the size. So here, the rows, they allow the user to specify what is the height of the text area that the user wants, and calls allow the user to increase or decrease the width of the text area. And if you want some default value, you can use the value attribute. Similarly, if you need ID and name, which are optional for us right now, but these can also be inserted in case if JavaScript is required later on. Next is buttons in HTML. Input elements of type submit are rendered as buttons. Now, you may require the buttons for different tasks. If you want to simply submit the form, then you can take type as submit. But if you want to clear the form, you want to clear all the entries within your form, and you just want to reset it, just write type equals to reset. Optionally, you can also use the value attribute if you want to change the text over the button. If you simply want submit and reset as the text that is visible on the button, then these two attributes, the value attribute, can be omitted. But if you want something different, let's say I need submit form. So if you want to write submit form on your button, then you will have to write submit form within the value attribute. And if you want to, let's say, clear the form, and you want to write down clear form over the button, then you can write value equals to clear form. But if you simply want submit and reset, these are not required. Buttons can also be used as a button tag. So you can also use button tag as type equals to submit. And you also need to specify that with which form do you want to associate it. So that time it is important for us to use the form attribute equals to, then you can specify the ID of the form. And you can also use the value of the submit button. And in order to show the text within the button, you need to write any text within the opening and closing tags of this button. Now, this button element is a pair tag, but if you have seen the input type equals to submit and input type equals to reset, they were not pair tags, they are unpaired tags. Then we have checkboxes. Input elements of type checkbox are rendered by default as boxes, which are checked or ticked when activated. These elements appear as small boxes, which you can tick mark, and further you can submit the form. Let's say normally you have seen in websites, I agree to the terms and conditions. There is always a small box which can be tick marked, and further the form can be submitted. Or let's say you have been asked about more than one choice. You have been asked about your hobbies. So hobbies cannot be just one. You can be asked about multiple. So there can be multiple options: swimming, reading, dancing. You can tick mark all those options. So that time checkboxes are useful. Now, how to insert them? You can use input type equals to checkbox. This much is enough. Optionally, ID and name attribute can also be used. Further, we have drop-down boxes. The select HTML element represents a control that provides a menu of options. If you want to show your user a list and you want your user to choose from that list, then you can use the drop-down menu, which can be inserted with the help of a select tag. We have one example right now in order to know how you can insert the select tag or the drop-down menu. We need to use the select tag and give it some name or ID. And in order to generate the list, we use the option tag. Both select tag and option tag are paired tags. Remember that we need to insert all the options within the select tag, that is within the opening and closing tags. The option, inside the option tag, you need to specify the value. The value is actually for the server side. Whenever you are submitting the form, the server needs to know, or the database needs to know, what is the value that you are submitting. So that time it is important for us to include a value. Otherwise, this value will not be visible on the web page. In order to make the same value visible to the user, or the text visible to the user, you need to write down the text within the opening and closing tag of the option. So let's say this is our first option. The first option says, please choose an option. Then the second one is dog. Then you have cat, hamster, parrot, spider, and goldfish. As you can see, everywhere within the option tag, this text is written. So you need to understand the text that is written here will be visible to the user. The text which is written within the value attribute will not be visible to the user. That is only for the database or the backend or the server side purpose. Now let's see how we can insert radio buttons. The input elements of type radio are generally used in radio groups, collections of radio buttons, describing a set of related options. These are, you can say, kind of opposite of checkboxes. These appear as small circles which can be selected. And you always need to select just one option. You cannot select multiple options. Let's say you are asked about your gender and you can only select one option. So that time the radio buttons are useful. Means whenever you are required to choose just one value. These can be inserted using input type equals to radio. Then you have file select. The input elements with type equals to file let the user choose one or more files from their device storage. Once chosen, the files can be uploaded to a server using form submission. Now you must understand that we are using type equals to file in order to let the user to choose a file and upload it on your website. And it can be inserted using input type equals to file. Now we are going to create our HTML form. So first of all, we will insert the form tag. And there is a default action attribute which we are going to discuss later in this lecture. And now let's insert a heading. And we are going to write, let's say, don't have an account. Don't have an account. So do you want to join us? So such kind of message or text we can write. Want to join us? Okay. Now after this, so we got this heading. Now within the form tag, let's start inserting our form controls label. And there's a default for attribute. So first of all, we are going to do it for the name. We want the user to enter the name. So let's write here name. This is the text which will be visible to the user. It is a label for the form element that now we are going to insert. So let's write input type equals to text. And you see that a text box has been inserted with a label as name. Now further, we also have an optional attribute, a placeholder. There are actually so many attributes which can be used within a form element. So let's say we want a watermark to be visible within the text box. And you can write here first name, last name. First name and last name. And if I zoom in, you will see a watermark and I can start typing my name. Okay, let's proceed. Now we have inserted our very first form element. After this, let's insert another one. We need another label tag. And now for we are going to use, we want the user to enter the email. Email. And then we need input type equals to. So input type equals to text also can be used, but for getting the email as input from the user, we also have type equals to email. So there's not much difference between a text box and an email. Only thing is that in email, you will not be allowed to enter any wrong value. You always need to enter the right email. An email consists of @ and .com. So you must have all these characters inside an email. We will discuss this when we are going to submit the form using the button. Now after the email, the next one we can insert is a drop-down menu. So we can ask the user to enter the cities. Like you want the user to enter or select the city to which the user belongs to. We can write down here cities and can write select city and okay, select city, and then after this we need to write down the select tag. Now within the select tag we are going to use the option tag option. Now as many option tags, as many items you want in your list, those many option tags can be inserted. So name can be inserted as cities. And the option, let's say the first one I need is just wanting the user to select some value. So this is just a simple message. You can see that this drop-down menu is now appearing. And there's a small arrow indicating that it is actually a drop-down menu. Now we need to show further some list. Now after this, we can insert more option tags. We can give it some value, let's say Noida. And we can include one more option. And let's say Delhi. We can insert Delhi here as well. You must notice, as already discussed, that value is for the database. This doesn't show anything on the web page. So it is important for you to write some value within the opening and closing tags. Right, now if you see, you will be able to see Noida and Delhi in the drop-down menu. But if I delete that text within the option tag, and you will notice that there is some empty list. List is there, but there's no text. So it means that in order to make the user visible the text, it is important to write down the text within the option opening and closing tags. Let's generate another item. Value, let's say I need now Mumbai. Let's write Mumbai here as well. And we are able to see the next city as well. And let's say now I need Bangalore. And we can make this also visible to the user. So let's check. So each and every item, that is each and every city, is now visible. Now one more thing is that all these form elements, since we are using the for attribute inside the label, so it will be much better if we are using the ID attribute inside each and every form element, because the for attribute is actually associated with the ID attribute of that specific form element. So you can write down here ID, though it may not be required at this point. It's not going to make any change. So next is email, input type equals to email. So we can write ID equals to email. And here as well, we can write ID as cities. So we got all this form for the timing. For now, it is appearing to be very simple form, but it will be great afterwards when we will be inserting some CSS. Now let's insert another form element, and that is the text area. So let's use first of all label. I write here address, and the text to be visible should be address. After inserting this label, we need the text area as the tag. You can give it some name, some ID, and name, let's say ID I can give as address, and here also I can change it to small address. Right, so you see that it is visible to us. The text area is quite large. Let me just get back to the original size. Right, so it's visible for us right now. So now after this text area, we need another label. And that is for the radio buttons. So we can insert here gender. We can ask the user to enter the gender or to select the gender. We will write here input type equals to radio. And you see one radio button is now visible to us on the web page. And you can give it value, let's say male. Now this value is actually again for the database or the server side purpose. If you want to make this visible to the user, then obviously you will have to write down the text right after this tag. And now let's insert another one. Input type equals to radio, and value we can insert is female. And we need this text to be visible to the user. We can insert one more. Let's say input type equals to radio, and value is others. So after saving the file, you will be able to see that three radio buttons are now visible. You can also write here others. Right. Now the last one that we are going to use is, you want the user to upload some file. Input type equals to file. And before this, we can use a label. And here we can write upload file. Upload file as the label. Upload file. So you can see that the user can now click and choose any file. Okay, so that's great. Now the last thing that we need to insert is input type equals to, we need a submit button. So you can use submit. A submit button is visible here. So right now if you click, nothing will happen. And we need another button that will allow us to reset. So also if you need to change the text, let's say submit form. So now you must know that what is the purpose of this value attribute within the input type equals to submit or input type equals to reset. We can also include one more form element, and that can be, let's say you want the user to enter the password. So you can write your password. A password can be inserted with the help of input type equals to password. So you can see that another text box is inserted. Let me zoom in. This is the password actually. And if you type anything, it will not be visible. It is just like the actual password when you write the password and you don't want anyone to see it. So that is why this is a security system, that the actual characters are not visible. I can understand right now the form is looking really messy. But if we don't have any other option, we can simply use a break tag so that every form element is visible in the new line. But we can also use CSS. Right now, for the time being, let's use a break tag. Okay, there seems to be one mistake here. The select tag was supposed to be closed here. Yeah, it is fine now. So that is why this address label wasn't visible initially. Okay, so after each and every element, we can use a break tag. This is our first one, that is a text box. So I'll write here break tag. Right, and then we have email. Here we can use a break tag. Then after this we have the email. Okay, email is done. Now next is the drop down menu. Okay, nice. Then after this we have the text area. We can use break tag. Nice. And after all the radio buttons, we can have one more break tag. Great. And then we have password. So what I'm doing, I'm simply inserting break tags, and you can also do the same thing. It's nothing hard in this. After each and every form element. So we forgot to insert it after the password. Here it is not required. It seems fine now. Let's have the input type equals to submit and reset together only. Right now it looks better as compared to the previous messy form. Let's now perform some CSS on our form so as to make it look attractive. So come to the style tag, and within the style tag we are going to first of all style the body. Now within the body, let's say I need font family, and the font family I need is this. And you can see the font family has been changed. Further, I would like to include some background image. And I need the URL of the image. The image that I'm going to insert is, I'm already having one image, background.jpg. So the background image is now inserted. May not look great at this point, but let's proceed. We are going to perform more styling. Now, after this, we need to use the background size as cover, background size cover, and then use background position as center. The centrally position, now use background repeat as no repeat. So we can see that only this, the form is now covering the whole viewport. And you see that we have written background repeat as no repeat. Right now it's visible this way because the size of the browser is diminished, and that is why it is covering only this much portion. Okay. Now, next is, we need to include our form within the div tag. So let's wrap our form within a div element. And close it here. It is important because we need to give some styles to our form, for which the div element is important. Now we need to make our form centrally aligned. For this, we'll be using few important properties that will help you to centrally align any element on your web page, and hence will be helpful in your future projects as well. So for this, first of all, we need to set the height of the body to 100 VH. 100 VH stands for view height, viewport height. So you can see that there is a difference. It has been, the height of this background image has been set to 100 viewport height. Then next is, you need to make your body as display flex. It will now start acting as a flexible container. Then further, you need to centrally align this form by using two important properties, and they are justify content. If you write justify content as center, you will be able to notice that it is now aligned in the center. But right now it is on the y-axis, on the x-axis. So further we now need to centrally align it on the y-axis. And let's write now align items center. And you can see that it is now centrally aligned on the y-axis as well. Now we need to style our label elements in such a way that all of these form elements are properly aligned one after the other. We don't want these form elements to start in the same line. Though we already have used break tags, but they are not the best option. So you need to write your label and just display them as a block level element. So if you remember, we discussed the block level elements. The block level elements always start in a new line, and you can see the same thing here. Now every label and the form element will start from a new line, and we don't even now need to use any break tag. You can remove it if you want. Now further, we have now a way to include some margin below each and every form element, and that is by using the margin property. We'll be using margin bottom, give it 10px, and yeah, that's it. And you see again, I have maximized the view. The form looks better as compared to the previous one. Now we need to style our div element. So we write div and give background color as white. The white background has been inserted, but you can give it some transparency by using the alpha of the RGBA. It seems fine now. Now we can include border radius. And border radius, let's say we use 10px. 10px border radius has been applied here. Then give some padding to your div tag, 50px. Some padding is also applied, as you can see here. Then further, we need to give width as well. I'll write here 400px. So that's nice. Let's maximize and check. So this is how the form looks right now. Yet we have not applied the styles to our form elements. We just have applied styles to the body tag and the div tag. Now let's start styling our form elements as well. Now we will have to write input. If you want to style all your input tags in the same way, just simply write input and write down the styles. But if you want different, then you can specify the square braces, that's the square brackets, and write down the type equals to text. Similarly, if you need to style another element in the same way, you can write input type equals to another, let's say email. Next, again we have input type equals to password. Right now I'm writing this because you need to know how we can style one particular element of the input tag. Input type equals to password. Let's style the select tag as well and text area. Right. Now, first of all, we will give width as 100%. We need 100%. Right now, they are not reaching up to the width of this div. So let's take it as 100%. I write here 100%. Next. So you can see that the width of all these form elements has increased. Then we use padding. Padding will be used for increasing the space within the form element. So we write here 10px. And the space is now increased. Then give border. So right now we really don't think so that this border is required. If I zoom in, this border seems unnecessary. Well, this is all just perception and depends on the requirement. But I want that the border should be removed, so I can simply write none here. So it looks better. Then further, I'll be giving some border radius. Border radius, I'll give 5px border radius. So let's zoom in and check. Some border radius is also applied here. You can see. We maximize now. This is how the form looks now. And the text area, as you know, that is of adjustable size. But right now, I feel that it is occupying too much space. So we can change the total number of rows this text area is occupying. I can simply write here 5. Looks better. Okay, let's now start styling our buttons. That is submit form and the reset button. Let's come back to the style tag. And here we are going to specify input type equals to submit. Then input type equals to reset. And now we are going to first of all give background color. The background color, let's say if I choose brown. And now we will be changing the shade from here. Somewhere here I need the color, and we can change the transparency. Now we can change the text color over this button. We will change it to white. Then give some padding. Padding, let's say I need 20px. Let's keep it 10px for now. From all the four sides, it will consider 10px only. Then give border radius. Border radius, I'll insert 20px. Now let's remove the border as well. Border as none. Alright. We need to increase the distance between this choose file and these two buttons. So for this we can come to the HTML part and insert two break tags for now. Okay, so we have increased the distance between choose file and both the forms. Let's style the padding in a better manner. Let's say the first part I need is 10px, that is top and bottom, let it be 10px, and the left and right I can have as 20px. We already have done these conventions initially. Okay, seems better now. Next we need is whenever we are clicking inside all these text boxes, then we should be able to change the color. So for this we'll be using a pseudo selector called as focus. So we want that for all the input tags, whenever they are focused. Focused means that whenever you are clicking inside them or you have the intention to write inside it, so that time you can consider that your element is now focused. So you want it for the text area as well. You will have to write them separately. Focus and select as focus. Focus is also pseudo selector. We already have covered pseudo selectors in the past lectures. So we want that every time we are focusing on that element, then we should be able to change the background color that time. Now after saving, you will notice that whenever I am focusing upon my element, it is changing the background color of that element. So focusing can be done either via clicking, or you can also press the tab key. Let's say I am pressing the tab. So every time it will change the background color whenever you are focusing on the element. Now let's perform the hover pseudo selector over the button element, that whenever we are hovering over this button element, then the background color should change, or let's say the size can increase, and so on. So let's proceed with using the hover pseudo selector over the submit and the reset buttons. Input type equals to submit, and we need to write hover. Hover is also pseudo selector, which is already covered in the past lectures. And type equals to reset. Again, we need to use hover. Now we need to change the background color. Let's say the background color should be changed to, again, I'll specify brown only. And further, we can change their shade. And let's say somewhere I'm using this color. Randomly, I'm using this color for now. Let it be. And then we also need to increase the size. For increasing the size, we need to use transform. Transform is a property that allows you to change the size, or let's say rotate your element. It's a very vast property, but at this point we only need to increase the size, so I'll simply use scale. Using scale, we will be able to increase the size. Let's say I need to increase it 1.05 times. If you write here 2, then it will be double the size of the original. Now let's check. So you can see that it is increasing the size. Now we need that whenever we are hovering over the button, there should be a smooth transition. So for the smooth transition, we need to come back to these two buttons here. Wherever we are styling them, we can use transition. Transition is used for the smooth change in the property. Whenever it is increasing the size, or let's say it is rotating or changing its position or whatever, that time we can use this. We'll be using 0.5 seconds. So it will take some 0.5 seconds for increasing its size. Okay. Now, next is that whenever we are hovering over them, then their color should, the text color should change to black. All these properties may or may not be required. It all depends what you like. Okay, right now I feel that this color is not required, so let's delete it. And all we want is that whenever we are hovering over this button, our cursor should change to a pointer. So you can see that our cursor is now changed to a pointer. Let's now maximize the browser and see how our form looks. So now you can see it has improved a lot as compared to the time when we just started inserting the form elements. Okay, that's nice. Now if you feel that you can improve it further by using more styles, you can go for it. Right now I feel that this join as text can be brought in the center. So for this, we can come to the styles and we can style our H2 tag. And right here, simply text align as center. It looks enough for now. For improving further, you can consider more styles from your site. Till now, we haven't used any attributes within the form element. Now, let's see what are those attributes. The first one is an action attribute. The HTML action attribute is used to specify where the form data is to be sent. Like where you want to submit your form after you have submitted your form. Right now, we don't know when we click on the submit button what happens. Actually, nothing happens when you click on the submit button, because you only have the front end. Actually, you can connect your HTML file with a backend file. In the backend file, the code for submission to the database is written. So right now, you can only understand the syntax, as connecting your HTML file to a backend file is out of the scope of this course, means out of the scope of the syllabus. So all you can understand is the syntax. So within the form tag, write down action attribute and type the name of that backend file. Further, the next attribute is method attribute. The method attribute defines how you want to send the data. So the action attribute was where to send the data, and method is how do you want to send the data. Basically, there are of two types. The first one is the get method. It's the default value even if you're not using the method attribute. So the default will be get. In the get method, after the submission of the form values will be visible in the address bar of the new browser. After you have filled out your form and you are submitting your form, in the address box of your browser, you will be able to see all those values that you are trying to submit. You will better understand when we will be doing the practical. And it has a limited size of about 3000 characters. It's only useful for non-secure data and not for sensitive information. The next type is the post method. In the post method, after the submission of the form values will not be visible in the address bar of the new browser tab. So it's the opposite of the get method. And it has no size limitation. Let's implement the action and method attribute. Let's get back to our form and use the action attribute. This action attribute can be linked to a backend file. Right now we don't have a backend file, but still we can write a file name which is not existing. So I have written the extension as .php because PHP is actually a backend language where we can connect our HTML file with the database. So all you need to now take care is just have a look at the address bar and you see lecture9.html. Now, when I'm going to submit the form, you see that there is a change in the address bar URL. Now, abc.php starts appearing. So means where you are submitting your form. You want to submit the file to abc.php. So, right when you submit the form, this file will start appearing in the URL. Now, before proceeding with the method attribute, you must ensure that each of your form elements is having the name attribute. So, I have already included a name attribute here. Any value you can give to this name attribute. Right. Now, let's have a look at the address bar once again. What you see is lecture9.html. Initially, when we submitted the form, we were able to see abc.php, which is understandable. But after abc.php, there is a question mark and you see some segment in the URL. This part of the URL shows what are the values submitted by you. Right now, we did not write anything in the form. That is why it is showing name equals to nothing. And email equals to nothing, city is equals to select, password equals to nothing, and so on. Now, the point is that why this is visible? It's visible because the default value of the get method is get. The get method will always show you the query string. In the query string, it will show you all those values which are submitted by you. Now, let's say if I include some values here, I'm right now including the values. And when I click on the submit form, now you will be able to see all those values in the query string. Now, I'm going to make it a bit larger for you so that you're able to see what is there in the query string. So after abc.php, there was a question mark. And as discussed, after the question mark, there is a query string which shows you the value submitted by you through your form. So right now the values submitted by me were name equals to my name. The space is occupied by a plus sign. Then there is the last name. Then email equals to my email. And then city is equals to Noida. Gender equals to female. Password equals to 123. File. There was no file that was selected by me to upload. So whatever the values you are inputting, same values will be visible here in the query string. So, all you need to understand is that if you are including a method attribute as get, get is the default value. So, always you will be able to see this in the query string. So, what is the purpose of get method? The get method allows you to submit the form and will always show the values in the address bar, whatever the values that are submitted by you. So whatever the values you enter will be visible using the name attribute. So as you can see here, all these are this name, email, cities, then you have gender. These are the name attributes of your form elements. Now let's get back to the method attribute again, and now I'll write here post. What was the purpose of post method? The post method also allows you to submit the form, but using a post method, you cannot see the query string within the address box. Now again, let's write down some values. Now after writing the values, you must understand the difference between the get and post method. Now when I submit the form, do you see anything? So there is nothing. You only see the file to which your HTML file is connected, that is abc.php. There is no question mark indicating that there is no query string. So post method never shows the values in the address box. Hence post method is secure, but the get method is not secure. So hope the difference between the post method and the get method is clear. We have now approached the end of this lecture. So these are the references. And this is the program link. That's all for lecture number 9.